everyone, welcome back to my channel. I'm very, very hot right now. So I know I get a lot of remarks, oh my God, can't believe you're wearing a tank top, you're a whore, blah, blah, blah. Sorry, it's super hot, very muggy, I'm sweating to death. So that's why I got a tank top on, even though I probably shouldn't have to explain myself, but that's okay. Today, I'm gonna talk about Lisa McVeigh, and this story popped up onto my Facebook and I had to read the article right away. The article that I read, it said it was the most disturbing case of all time. There's actually a movie on Netflix about it, but it's not in America. You have to pay for it if you wanna watch it. But it is on Lifetime and the movie's coming on this Saturday, I believe at like 4 a.m. So I have it recorded. The article claimed that a lot of people couldn't even get through the whole movie. So I'm very interested to see if I'm going to be able to. You guys watched this movie. It's called Believe Me, The Abduction of Lisa McVeigh. So if you have seen this, definitely comment below and let me know if you've already watched this. It's gonna be a little bit of a long video, so I apologize for that. Even though I've been seeing a lot of people comment saying that they want longer videos from me, which I'm totally cool with. I just don't want to, I know I can ramble sometimes. I feel like I cut out a lot of video content on here just because I don't want to bore you guys to death, but I'll start making them longer. The only problem is with longer videos, it takes me longer to edit, record, get it up, all that kind of stuff, you know, take notes, research. So that's another reason it's taken me a little bit to get a video up. But if you guys like these type of videos, don't forget to like, subscribe, comment, blah, blah, blah. And again, I did drop some merch. I'm still working on it. It's a work in progress. I'm not super witty. I can't always come up with the greatest things like t-shirt things. So if you guys have any ideas, definitely leave them below, help a girl out. And let's just jump right into it. Lisa McVeigh lived in Tampa, Florida when she was 17 years old in 1984. And she has a really, really sad story growing up before she was even abducted when she was 17. So I'm gonna rewind a little bit and go back into her past history. She was born to a single mom and her mom had a lot of her own issues with addiction and substances and alcohol and things like that. And she couldn't really care for her. So at 2 years old, she was put into foster care. And from here, she would jump home to home until finally her grandmother was able to take her in, and her grandmother had a boyfriend at the time. When her grandmother took her in, she was about 14 years old, and sadly, the boyfriend of the grandmother was not a great person. He started to sexually and mentally hurt her, and during this, he would always hold a gun to her head. During this time, she worked at Krispy Kreme, which wasn't far from her home, so she would ride her bike all the time to get there. So November 3rd, she was 17 years old. She ended up going to her shift at Krispy Kreme. She decided to work a double that night, last minute. She typically didn't work doubles, but she called her grandmother, asked if she could work the double shift, which means she'd be getting off at like 2 a.m. Her grandmother said yes. And about 2 a.m., she closes up the shop and she gets on her bike to ride home. This is where she doesn't make it home, sadly. Her bike is found in the middle of the street, about halfway from Krispy Kreme home, and it was all her belongings. Her purse was thrown on the ground, and she actually, there was donuts on the ground too because she was bringing some home. And the owner of the Krispy Kreme, the boss, ended up recognizing her bike and said it was hers, called the police, and instantly she was a missing person. Then, shockingly, at 4 a.m. 2 days later on November 5th, she comes walking back in her grandparents' house. She told them how she was kidnapped and they didn't believe her. They started beating her. They beat the shit out of her. They thought she was lying, making it up, and they did this over and over repeatedly for hours. So she got the shit kicked out of her for telling the truth of what happened to her. Well, I guess her grandmom finally came to her senses and decided to take her into the police. I don't know if she did that because she slightly started to believe her or because, you know, she wanted to get her in trouble because she thought she was making it up, but she's an awful person. As soon as she got there, she told the police everything. Let me tell you, as I get into this story, this girl is a genius. She's brilliant. She's smart. These police officers were completely stunned. This is where it's like really deep, so trigger warning, I'm just gonna let you know. She told the police that the reason she worked that 2 a.m. shift is because she didn't want to go home. She had actually left a suicide note at her house before she went to work because when she got home, she planned on sadly taking her own life. And the note was dated November 3rd. What's really interesting is that she told the police that when she was working that Krispy Kreme shift, when she went to leave, she was offered a ride home and she actually declined because when she got home, she knew what her plan was to do. And she kind of just wanted that time by herself because she really thought she was, you know, gonna go through with it. She wanted to ride home alone and just like take that all in. What she said what happened was she was riding home and there was a parking lot of a church, and because it was so late, there was a maroon car in the church, and she looked over like, that's kind of weird, like I've never seen that before, what's this random car doing in this parking lot? And she said she was riding her bike and she looked back, and as soon as she looked back, she was knocked off her bike because she was smacked on the back of her head. She said when she came to, woke up and realized what was going on, he had a gun to her head and she could actually hear it click. She said that she was scared at first and kind of screamed because it shocked her. She wasn't expecting that to happen. But she said she wasn't really scared because, you know, this has been going on for her whole life, you know, for so many years. So he puts her in her car and immediately makes her strip and, sickly enough, made her perform different acts on him. I'm sure you can imagine what I'm talking about. She said he then tied her up with bed sheets and blindfolded her, but when he blindfolded her, what she did was like she scrunched her face like that so that her face would seem bigger. So when the blindfold went on and she unscrunched her face, it would leave a little room so she could, you know, see down. She could see up a little bit without him knowing, which was so brilliant. And the reason she did this is because she was really into true crime. She was a true crime junkie. She watched all the shows, things like that. So she had picked up little tips like that along the way, and I'm gonna explain these all throughout the video. But she put this blindfold on. He had no idea she could see things. Not everything, but she could see some stuff. Now, like I said, he had no idea who he was taking when he took her. She was a force to be reckoned with. She had dealt with evil her whole life. She had been in survival mode her whole life, so this wasn't anything different for her. She was gonna do whatever she could to get out of this situation. Because of her love of crime shows and always watching them, she knew she had to remember everything of what she seen, smelled, heard. She uses all of her senses to really put so many pieces together. She looked down in the car and she saw like dark red carpet. She immediately knew she had to remember that. She could see a little bit of the steering wheel and she saw that it said Magnum written on the steering wheel, and she associated it with the show. That way she could remember the word that was on there. She also remembers seeing a little green light like next to the steering wheel, and she knew something was wrong with the car because it was making clicking noises. It was sounding like banging metal. It didn't sound right. It sounded like something was wrong with it. This is how brilliant this girl was. She was on her period and she had a tampon in. She ended up taking it out and leaving it there. That way her DNA was there, and that way, in case she was never found, they could link him to her. That is so smart. She said he randomly stopped. She didn't know where she was at, but when they got out, she could see a little bit of woods. This is where he made her get dressed and then led her into what she thought, she didn't know where she was entering, like into a building or something, but it was actually his apartment. She said as she walked in, she could smell harsh paint and chemicals. It smelled really, really clean, like somebody had been cleaning a whole bunch. She ended up seeing out of her mask a little bit. She said that he was white, that he had green floors, and he was left-handed. That's what she could make out of her blindfold. And he oddly takes her to the bathroom and starts bathing her with her mask on, almost like taking care of her. And she felt like, okay, something's up, this is weird. There's like, you know, more to it, what's going on? This is where she asks why he did what he did to her. And he tells her that he had just broken up with his girlfriend and that she wasn't the only girl he has done this to. As she was bathing, she was like trying to see what she could see, and she saw dark hair on the walls, like his hair had fell out, like he put it on the walls. I don't know, I do that too. So that's how she knew that he had dark hair. This girl was very, very smart. And I think from being so tortured her whole life to begin with, and she already knew these survival skills, she definitely used a form of reverse psychology on this guy. It's truly remarkable, but sadly, after the bath, then he, you know, sexually hurt her over and over again for the rest of the night. Then the next night, he ended up feeding her a meal in front of the TV in a living room. Like I said, the blindfolds on, acting like everything's totally normal. It was almost acting like she was his girlfriend, or like they had a relationship is how he was acting, except for minus, you know, physical abuse and everything like that. But it's almost like after he did horrible things to her, he would be nice to her, like he felt some sort of guilt. People are crazy as shit. Well, when they're in the living room and he's feeding her this meal, she said she could hear that her story came on the news that she was missing. And this is where he starts freaking out. He's like walking around, panting and huffing and puffing, and he's getting mad. What should I do with you? What am I gonna do with you? Oh my God, what's gonna happen? I need to get rid of you, things like that. And she's like, all right, I need to get myself together. I need to focus. What am I gonna do? I need to get myself out of this situation. So she asks to go to the bathroom alone because she couldn't go with him in there. She said she had like stage fright, and as soon as she got in there, she didn't know what to do, so she took her fingerprints and just smeared them everywhere, all over the walls, all over everything, so that if something happened to her, they again would know she was there. And that's very, very smart of her. So again, that night after the bathroom, same thing, he sexually hurts her and then he makes her sleep next to him. She said she didn't try to get up or leave after this because she was terrified that he wasn't really asleep, like he was testing her and wanted to see what she would do, if he could trust her. So she just laid there awake all night. Then that night at 4 a.m. he wakes up freaking out, frantic again, like, what am I gonna do with you? And she was terrified, you know, because he had said already that this isn't the first time he's done this. So she's thinking, you know, this is the end. So what does she do? She tries to at least somehow relate to him, or, you know, try to make him happy in some weird way. She tells him, I understand what you're going through. I understand that you're mad at your ex-girlfriend for leaving you. I'll be your girlfriend. We'll act like this never happened. Whatever you want to do, like, I'll tell them whatever you want me to tell them. She really starts telling him whatever he wants to hear, basically, because she just wants to live. She basically used that little bit of information that he told her in the tub to manipulate him. And she was so smart for doing that, because I think if she didn't do that, she might not be here to tell the story. She says that during this, she would talk to him like he was a little kid, and trying to calm him down and soothe him and say, it's gonna be okay. Everything's gonna be okay. I'll go along with whatever you want me to do, like, it's all right. So this is where he tells her to get dressed and get in the car. Remember, it's 4 a.m. And he asks where she lives. So she tells him, and he gets in the car. They go to a bank and then they go to a gas station. She could have gotten out and ran, she said, but she really, you know, wanted to survive. She didn't know, again, is it a test? Is it not a test? Is he getting out of the car and watching her to see if she tries to run? Again, it's 4 a.m. She probably couldn't get any, like, really far if she even tried to. So she stayed put. So they're driving again. And again, like I said, she has her blindfold on, but she could tell that they were going around an interstate and kind of passing the area where it would go to her house. And she's like, where are we going? And she said that he started getting frantic again, like unsure. And this is where she like baby talked him and soothed him and told him it was going to be okay. Then she gives directions to him to get her back home. And this is where they get back home to her area and they get to this road. And he ends up hugging her and letting her out, and says he's sorry for everything that he put her through. And then he tells her to sit on the curb for 5 minutes if she wants to live when he drives off. He drives off, she sits on that curb for 5 minutes, and she's, you know, terrified. She didn't know if it was another test. After that 5 minutes was up, she takes off her blindfold and she starts running. She was panicking that he'd be back for her. And then she gets home, and like I said, her parents beat her for telling them what happened. Well, the sketch artist in the police station, she said that they brought him in and they didn't think she would be able to really give much info because she had a blindfold on. And this is where they were completely stunned. She had so much detail to be able to give them. When she was telling the sketch artists what he looked like, She says that at one point he ended up putting her hands like all over his face. She was able to give him tons of description on what his facial features were like. She said that he had small ears, a small mustache, short hair, clean cut, kind of stout, but not overweight, but he was a big guy. She said when she was talking to the investigator, she had to be really calm because she knew that was the only way to get all the information out there so that they could find this guy before he hurt other women. And because she was so strong and brilliant and just such a survivor, they ended up capturing Bobby Joe Long, and he ended up pleading guilty to 8 murders, as well as the assault and kidnapping of Lisa. He ended up getting 28 life sentences and a death sentence for the killing of 22-year-old Michelle Sims. He was actually executed in May of 2019. And what's awesome is Lisa is now a motivational speaker. And what's really amazing and incredible about this story is that, thank God, and she even says this in her letter, that thank God they didn't choose another 17-year-old girl. Thank God he chose her because she was able to get this man and put him away. And now luckily he's executed and there's a little less evil on this earth. Even though things may be, like I said, terrible, like she had a horrible, horrific childhood, but she was still meant to be on this earth for a reason. And I'm so happy that she's still here because she's an incredible, incredible woman. So I hope you guys like this video. Don't forget to subscribe and I'll see you soon.